Thank you very much for this, for inviting me to this timely conference. I will speak in the next 15 minutes about the prospects for regional natural gas developments. As we all know, major deposits of natural gas were discovered offshore Israel, and to some extent also 150 kilometers south to Limassol in Cyprus. It's about 1,000 cubic meters of proven reserves, which is a nice deposit. Not to overstate or emphasize, it is excellent for Israel. And in fact, in a very rapid manner, Israel managed to develop its natural gas industry. And right now, about 60% of the electricity is being generated by natural gas, which is being supplied from an offshore field, Tamar field, which is located, and we'll see it in a minute in a map, 100 kilometer offshore Haifa, in a water depth of 1,600 meters, and then 150 kilometer pipeline to a platform which is located 20 kilometer offshore Ashkelon, also 20 kilometer offshore Gaza. And this is an excellent for Israel because electricity prices has decreased significantly, and also most of the industry in quantity, the major industries like Dead Sea Works, refineries, paper mills, and so on and so forth, are already getting relatively cheap gas. And the contribution to the economy is huge. Israel saves about 5 to 6, just a minute, sorry. Saves about $5 to $6 billion dollars a year just for saving of imports of oil and to some extent coal, and this is a major contribution to the Israeli economy. So just to show you the map, you see, this is an economic zone, or the exclusive economic zone of Israel, which is larger than the size of the country itself. And these are the deposits, the Tamar deposit, which was discovered 6 years ago, almost seven, and this deposit, the Leviathan, which is a huge deposit, the largest which was found in the world in the past decade. And not far from there, about 50 kilometers, there is the Aphrodite field, which is in the exclusive economic zone of Cyprus. Now, these deposits, which are very close to another other deposits offshore Egypt, for example, the Zuhr deposit, which is located here, where I show the arrow, which only discovered a few months ago, but Eni, the major Italian conglomerate, and which is most likely the size of Leviathan or even larger. So just to show you, for example, right now, as mentioned, that Israel is being supplied from gas from the Tamar field, as you see here the map. And here the map, this is the field, and this is a pipeline or two parallel pipelines which are connected to this platform, located, as mentioned, 20 kilometers offshore Ashkelon and Gaza, and one pipeline to shore.
We cannot see. Can you close the lights, please?
Please do that. And indeed, basically, as mentioned, that's a great contribution to the Israeli economy, but also a major, I would call it national security threat. Because right now, as mentioned, 60% of the power is generated basically from gas from one field. Again, 100 kilometers offshore, 1,600 meter water depth. As you see here, that's five wells, two parallel pipelines, one platform, and this is remotely controlled 150 kilometers away from this platform. And I'm really scared from a technical problem, because this is one pipeline which connects, basically connects this gas to shore here in Ashdod. Not needless to say about the strategic threats to Israel, and already the last war, summer of 2014, several missiles were launched by Hamas on that platform. And Mr. Nasrallah already said several times that this platform is waiting and sitting like a sitting duck, because this is the most strategic location, one of the most strategic location in Israel. And according to foreign military analyst, Israel doesn't have yet the comprehensive defense solutions to defend, to protect this platform and also the infrastructure. So this is a major, it's a national security concern and threat to Israel. And therefore, from a purely, I would say, national security reasons, there is a must and a need to develop additional supply source to Israel. And this is a pipeline from Leviathan field, which was not developed yet. And there are other smaller fields like Arish and Tanin. And as an energy, in an energy strategy of a country, at least three independent supply sources, which will take at least 4 to 5 years to construct. And possibly also there is a smaller deposit offshore Gaza, the Gaza Marine gas field. And I believe right now we started to work on a natural or an energy master plan for Palestine for the second time. We did last year, the World Bank is doing. We are the major author of this study. And we are looking at ways to find the political, of course, but economic rationale and markets also for the Palestinian gas, because it can be a very important income source to the Palestinian Authority. I'll say something in a minute about that. So Israel did, in fact, the fastest in the world was the shift to natural gas. I would say even too quickly, as mentioned, because of the security threat, the dependence on one field, which which is causing a major security and economic problem to the nation. Now, what about regional cooperation and development? What about the export options that East Mediterranean gas, I say the Israeli gas, to some extent, and also the Cypriot gas? A lot is being said about that and discussions, and it's very easy to draw pipelines on the map, and it is also very important. So where are the markets, in addition to the Israeli market itself, which will grow slowly? Already, as mentioned, most of the market is already being served. So there is a small potential for hundreds of smaller and intermediate industries, possibly, and this is the vision that we really hope that Israel will take upon itself, to shift half of its auto fleet to natural gas in 20 years' time. It is possible in three major technologies: compressed natural gas, also the production of methanol from methane, from natural gas, a fluid like benzene, and electric cars. Because if we are going to produce about 70% in the future of our electricity from gas, that can produce electricity to charge batteries. So this is a vision to a country which has relatively cheap gas, and this is something that can be done, and I think it's a very entrepreneurship country, and relatively cheap gas, to it is possible to do that, and I think in this respect, this is a vision to the nation. But the market, the domestic market, is limited, so to develop, to justify the development of investment of billions of dollars. For example, the Leviathan field, it's about $6 billion of investment. So you really need an anchor market. So where are the markets in the region for this gas? First, Egypt. It was discussed, Egypt has about threefold the reserve of natural gas, the proven reserve that Israel has. But in the past 6-7 years, there's a major shortage of gas in Egypt. And why that? It's because Mubarak, who ruled the president of Egypt for about 30 years, from 1981 to 2011, basically he made a major brought the Egyptian economy to a major crisis. And the major reason for that was that for 30 years, subsidies for energy from the Egyptian government was about 35% to 40% of the Egyptian government every year was directed through subsidized energy. Very cheap gasoline and diesel, very, very cheap electricity prices, very cheap gas prices. So from an economic point of view, I started to work on Egypt already in 1990, 25 years ago. I started to work in the World Bank. The IMF and the World Bank all the time alerted Egypt to start to decrease subsidies, to increase prices. It was not done, which really is a major cause for this major economic crisis which Egypt is experiencing. What else happened is that because the international companies, which are partners with the Egyptian national petroleum company, it's about usually 50% investment of the international company or 100% investment of the international company, the owner, 50% of the equity in the various offshore and onshore gas fields. So the price in the domestic market was so low that the international companies stopped to develop new fields because the price was too low. Now, President Assisi, in the past year and a half, almost from June, I think, of 2014, almost 2 years, so the first month in his position, what he did, he raised energy prices and lower subsidies, and he doubled the gasoline and diesel prices and increasing electricity prices and introduced very, very high and prices for gas for the international companies, which immediately, in no time, signed contracts of tens of billions of dollars to develop new fields offshore Egypt. It will take Egypt, I think, one decade, at least 10 years, just to overcome the gap and to shorten the shortage. And then I don't think that very quickly it will decide to export gas. I don't see Egypt exporting gas in the near future. Maybe in the next 15 years or more, but I think it learned a lesson. Egypt exported gas to Israel, to Jordan, until 2011. And then this pipeline, which exists, offshore Sinai, and then onshore in the northern Sinai, and then offshore pipeline to Israel, supplied gas for 2 years, from 2009 to 2011, and also a pipeline here from El Arish to Aqaba, and supplied 90% of the electricity of Jordan. So what happened in 2011? Bedouin and other terrorist groups started to bomb and explode this pipeline for more than 20 times since then, and electricity and gas export ceased, and basically in Israel electricity prices have increased by 35% because Israel Electric shifted to burn heavy fuel oil and diesel, so there was no electricity shortage. But what happened in Jordan, because there was so much dependent on the Egyptian gas, there were major electricity cuts for weeks in Amman, in other places, until they converted their power stations to heavy fuel oil, to diesel, and it caused a major economic crisis in Jordan of more than $7 billion, same time with about 1 million refugees from Syria entered the country, so it's a major shortage, a major economic crisis because of the dependency on one source. So is Egypt a source for exporting Eastern Mediterranean gas? Possibly. There are two idle LNG liquefaction plant located east to Alexandria. One is located here in Idku. It was constructed about a decade ago. Investment of billions of dollars by British Gas. These days, Royal Dutch Shell purchased British Gas. And another one by Union Fenosa Gas. Damietta. So the idea is, and that was a letter of intent which was signed, that from Leviathan, a submarine pipeline of 400 kilometers will be supplying gas to this idle LNG plant of BG, now Shell, and from Tamar Field, offshore pipeline to the other LNG idle plant. In these days where energy prices collapsed by about 70%, the likelihood of the materialization of those projects is doubtful. It might be that they are not going to be launched. So where is the market for East Mediterranean gas? Possibly in Jordan. Jordan didn't wait. They also signed a letter of intent, the electricity company of Jordan, to import gas from Leviathan field. But about 7 months ago, they started to import LNG in Aqaba, liquefied natural gas. And these days, the cheap, very cheap gas. They're still the king and the Egyptian government wish to import gas from Israel. There was a major opposition in Jordan for that. Islamic Brotherhood and other organization and the demonstrations against importing gas from Noble Energy, the operator, American company, and Delek, the Israeli partner, and so on. The most viable, so this is a question mark, whether this project will materialize. The most viable project is exporting gas to Turkey. This is very economically viable, but still a question mark regarding the political viability of that. So there are signs, and possibly there might be a room for rehabilitation of the bilateral relations between Turkey and Israel. And Turkish companies and European companies continue to negotiate with the developers of Leviathan for the development of this field to supply gas to Turkey. But you really need the economic viability and you need the political will. The political will might be there in the future. Also, from practical reasons, there is a need for the consent of Cyprus to go through its economic, exclusive economic zone. So I don't think that the solution of resolution of the Cyprus problem is a condition for construction a pipeline. I think that Cyprus will provide it consent, possibly with some, if this project will become politically viable in the future, with some conditions that possibly in the future also Cypriot gas might be mobilized through such a pipeline to Turkey and possibly one day via Turkey to Europe. Exporting gas from East Mediterranean via Cyprus to Greece is not technically economically viable. There is no enough gas these days. It's about $10 to $15 billion of investments. So right now it's a pipe dream. But it is important. It is important to conclude the feasibility study we run, our company, a pre-feasibility study. It doesn't make sense right now economically, but maybe one day it will, especially if much more gas will be discovered in the region. To conclude, there is scope for a cooperation between Israel and Cyprus, possibly together to export gas to Egypt if it will become viable. Also, Shell, right now the owner of the LNG, the idle LNG plant in Egypt, might be willing politically to import gas from Cyprus, not from Israel. Shell's eyes directed to Iran these days. It's another complication. But no doubt that the discoveries of Eastern Mediterranean gas brought food for agenda for discussions and cooperation, especially between Israel and Cyprus, possibly in the future Israel and Turkey, maybe in the future also Cyprus and Turkey. So with all the problems, needless to say, rivalry, I would say, the disputes over marine borders between Turkey and Cyprus, between Turkey and Greece, some limited, very small dispute between Israel and Lebanon over the marine delineation of the marine border. This is a really small dispute, 850 square kilometers. So there is a lot of room for further negotiations, development, but we need to be realistic. We really need to be realistic. You see the pipeline from Azerbaijan, Azerbaijan via Georgia, across Turkey, and then from Turkey, this is a type, via Greece to Italy, is under construction. It is taking 30 years from 1991 until the gas will flow to Europe, possibly in 2020, 2021. So you really need a very long vision for such multi-billion dollars like that, and especially in a period where energy prices are so low, with so much such high complexity, geopolitical complexity, we all need to be patient and rational, and you really need, as mentioned, the economic viability of those projects, and of course, one, there is a window of opportunity to have a geopolitical viability, need to take that into account, take advantage of that. So to summarize, I would say that maybe in the future also floating LNG will be possible, but this is in the long run. There is it's an excellent thing that happened to the nations, the discoveries of huge natural gas resources. Countries and people need to be patient, and unless government will finance, and I don't feel this is a situation that government will finance the development of those fields, so the market, the right market conditions should be right in place to allow these developments, which hopefully will benefit all the nations in the region. Thank you.